rain showers. Get that. My understanding, according to my iPad, is we're going to get another one this afternoon. That's okay. I don't have to water my flowers. I don't have to water my lawn. But I do have to weed. Anyway, thank you very much for being here today. We have some interesting things coming up in June. Okay, kind of a busy month. Okay, on June the 13th, we're going to have a meeting here at the church with our interim moderator, Reverend Noel Ramsey, and he's bringing some members with him from the missions committee, and they're asking us about our plans and our visions for this church for the future. I think it's important that we show a good, strong support for our church, so I'm encouraging everybody that is able to attend, please be there. This includes all members, it includes adherents as well. If you're at all interested in this church and the plans and our vision for community for the future, please be there to make it known that you have a commitment to keep this church going as long as God wants this church to keep going. All right, so carrying on from that, then we have Bible study, which is usually at my place on Thursday night, but it's going to have to be canceled on June the 13th. And then we are going to take a break. We are not going to do Bible study through the summer months, so Bible study then will start up again in September, so I will give you lots of notice before that starts. So no more Bible study till September. June the 30th, we're going to not have a worship service that day. I've committed to having Brian take 5 weeks off, and it seemed kind of silly to have a church service on June the 30th when the very next day is July the 1st and everybody's going to be off on holidays. So there will be no church service on June the 30th. We're closed during the month of July, and then we will be back again for regular worship services on August the 4th. So mark that down in your calendar. We hope to see you back here again on August the 4th. Okay, next Sunday, Father's Day, of course, and we're going to have some special music, and we're also having communion that day. So mark that down in your calendar, and if there are people that are here that you are in touch with on the phone, get in touch with them, let them know Father's Day, we're having communion at the church. I don't think I have anything more, unless somebody here has something they'd like to add. Okay, so then Brian, your turn.
Thank you, Irene. Well, good morning, everyone. And to those who are watching on YouTube, good morning to you as well. Although you'll be looking at this in the afternoon or later. We're so glad for the technology that allows us to extend our Sunday morning service. Well, actually, around the world. I know we have folks in other countries, actually, who tell me that they're looking at the service, at least sometimes, anyway. So, God bless us all this morning. Glad that you're able to be here. We're going to begin our worship service this morning with our call to worship. Let's say together, the Lord is my rock, my protection, my savior, my God and my rock. I can run to him for safety. He is my shield and my saving strength, my high tower. Amen. Let's stand together and sing a great old hymn of the church, Great is Thy Faithfulness, number 324 in the blue book, and it's on the screen as well.
Bye.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence this morning, consciously aware of your presence with us. We know that you are here. Jesus, our Savior, promised us that whenever even two or three, as few as that, would be gathered in his name, that he would be there in their midst. We thank you, O God, that you don't look at numbers, you look at hearts. And so, Father, this morning as we come before you, we open our hearts and our lives to you, and we say, Lord, here I am, here we are, just as we are, as the old hymn says, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee. O Lamb of God, I come. And so as those words say, Lord, we come this morning before you, and we thank you that we can be here. We thank you that you've given us the desire to be here. And Lord, you've given us the strength, all that we need to be here. But mostly, Lord, we're here because you saved us when we were willing to come before you and admit our own sinfulness before you. You revealed yourself to us. And we thank you. Father, we pray today for our community of believers, for the community in which we live. Lord, we know that there are so many people today who are lost and struggling, and they've searched everywhere for answers and for solutions, and they've come up empty. So, Father, we pray at this time, considering all that's happening in the world around us today, things that we just don't understand, things that we never thought possibly could happen, you are here. Your light is still shining. And Lord, we pray that the light that we see will become a fire in our hearts that will stir us to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ our Lord in this place and in our lives for as long as you give us breath. Lord, we thank you today for our families, for our church family. There are some of our dear ones who are not well, and you know all of their names, but Lord, we bring them before you. The whole Thompson family, Lord, we know, you know what's going on there far better than we do. So, Father, we pray you'll touch their hearts and bring healing as it's your will. You know our will, Lord, is that we would all be fit and healthy and strong to live lives of joy and service to you. Father, we also think of this morning of Dave and Joyce who are not well and recovering. We pray for our dear brother Gary today who's not well and is getting better. We thank you for him. Lord, we know there are so many others, and as I pray, I just can't remember all of the names of folks that really do need our prayers. Some are in difficult circumstances. Some have financial problems. Some are looking for work. Young people are looking for summer jobs. And little ones, Lord, are looking for love. And so we pray, Father, you'll help us to love the little ones and to love the big ones too. Lord, we don't know anything about your love. We read about it, we hear about it. We thank you that we have felt it in our hearts, but Lord, there's so much more. That's why the Apostle Paul prayed so often that we would know the height and the depth, the length, the breadth of your love, how deep it is, how high it is, how wonderful and strong and unfailing and full of grace and compassion and forgiveness it is. Oh, Lord, teach us your love. Most of us who are here today have lived a long, long time. And we understand we're just beginning now to get it, to scratch the surface of what your love really, really means. And yet, along with that love, Lord, we also don't understand your holiness. We know that you are a holy God. Your word tells us that you forgive us our sins, but you don't overlook them. And we know, Lord, that one day you promised that you will make all things right. We pray every Sunday, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray that, but Lord, we understand that. That means that it is your desire that peace and holiness, as well as wellness and goodness, will reign over this earth. That the light will completely not just push back the darkness, but one day destroy the darkness, along with that prince of darkness who now has control and thinks he has control, thinks he will win even though he has been defeated. Lord, and that brings us back to Calvary. We thank you, Lord, that Jesus paid it all. He brought hope to us. He brought forgiveness. He brought salvation. And one day, as he promised, he will return. And all things will be well again. We don't know all the details. Sometimes we think we do. But Lord, we're confident and satisfied enough to just leave it all to you. We thank you, Lord, that we can just take our foot off the pedal and just relax a bit, because we know that you're going to make things all work out for good, as you promised you would. All that we need to do is to love you and to know that we are called according to your purposes. So, Lord, help us as a church and as individuals to continue to find out what you want us to do, and then to resolve to be the kind of people that you want us to be and that we need to be. We pray, Father, for all those who are not here this morning. We pray for those who are watching by the internet. We know that some people maybe skip over parts of the service, but we pray they won't skip over this part, because they will know that we're praying for them and we care about them so much, so very, very much. So, Father, having committed our hopes and our dreams and our commitment for the future, having committed our own families and children and grandchildren, all of our loved ones into your care and protection, now, Lord, as your family, together we pray the wonderful prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we have forgiven those who trespass against us.
Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Well, hi everybody. Glad you're here. Let's greet one another.
Lord, have with us this, that he that calls the presence.
and for much, much joy. Do you remember what it was like to be that young and not have a care in the world? Oh, tell me about your experiences, because I forget. Anyway, we're thankful for our families, for all the little ones, and we pray that God will protect them. And we know Aunt Irene is saving up her stories, as she always does, for when the children come back again after the summer. I want us to stand now. And this is a hymn that's in our hymn book. It's just one verse, it's one chorus. And I've added a second verse to it, which is a personal commitment chorus. Let's stand together and sing this. It won't take us long. Here we go. This is the word of the Lord. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me?
How long is our trespass with my heart, and every day and sorrow in my heart? How long?
Look on me and answer, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death.
My enemies say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall.
But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation.
I will sing to the Lord, for he has
reasons to do it to me. Amen. Indeed, he has. Well, Aunt Irene, are you looking in your mirror? Can you see who's arrived at the back there?
Some kids here.
We had Haley and Keith are with us. Hi, guys.
Good morning.
Aunt Irene, could you?
Keith is out on his friend's birthday.
Yeah.
That's Holly.
Is that Holly? Oh, hi, Holly. With a hat on, I couldn't tell.
Come on up, boy.
Come on up for a story.
Come on, there you go. Oh, I love the hat. Whoa, that's a great cat in my eye.
Okay, are we ready for the day?
Yeah. Okay, good.
This is the light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine. This is the light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. That doesn't shine. I have a light inside me, and it shines. You know how I know the light shines? And I know your light shines, because I can see it shining. You know how I can see your light shining? How can I see your light shining? Your eyes. Look at your eyes. And your face, big smile. You are shining. You are beautiful. And so I brought in something today that shines. What does this say? It's a flashlight.
That's right.
And my flashlight shines. And my flashlight helps to show me the way. Just the same way that God helps to help me show the way. So I'm going to turn my flashlight on. You ready for this?
going to be really bright. You ready? Something's wrong with my flashlight. Gotta check this out. Why isn't it shining? Why isn't my light shining? It's no batteries in it. It's empty. Let's take a look. There's a screw in it.
Yeah, and there was a gem.
Yeah. You know what was inside it? Junk. And you know something? What should be inside it?
Battery.
A battery should be inside it, shouldn't it? So let me see if I can get the battery in the right way. With my luck, I won't. Let's try.
Because there was a lot of junk in it. It didn't make it.
If I put the battery in the right way, it should work, but for some reason or other, it's not going to. Oh, you know what?
There's more junk in it.
Yeah, there's more junk in it. I got to get all the junk out of my trunk. There we go. Got all the junk. Now let's see what happens. Let's see what happens now. Okay, wash your fingers. Okay, got fingers done? Okay, there we go. Put the battery in the wrong way?
Yeah.
Okay, let's try that. Okay, let's turn it around. Let's try this way. Okay, now let's try it. Oh! Now it's working! And you know something? This flashlight reminds us of us.
Yeah.
How can we shine if we're full of junk? What kind of junk might we be filled with? We might be filled with mean thoughts, or angry thoughts, or stubborn thoughts.
I don't want to go to bed, I'm staying up.
Those are the mean, nasty thoughts, wouldn't they? And so how can we shine? Shining means our eyes are shining, our mouth is shining, and we know that God loves us. And when we know that God loves us, and God will take care of us, we've got all kinds of reasons to shine, because we know he's always going to be there, he's going to watch over it, and he's going to protect us. And so when we shine, we let the whole world know we love Jesus, and he helps us to shine. So let's put our hands together. We put our hands together as we talk to God. Okay? Look at this. Dear God, help me to shine.
Help me to shine.
Help me to learn more about you.
Help me to learn more about you.
And how you love me.
And how you love me.
So that I will always, have eyes that shine. And a mouth that sings your praises. With a big smile. Thank you, God.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Okie dokie, Ruth, you downstairs? Nope?
Yeah.
Going to stay up? Up or down? What's it going to be?
Down.
Yeah. Oh, wait. Down. Yeah. Okay. Bye. I've got Noah's Ark down there for you.
Always be prepared. And she wasn't even a Boy Scout. Is that what the Girl Guides do? Did they always say be prepared? Okay, that they must, because she is always prepared. Will your anchor hold in the storms of life? Are you back? Good for you. Oh, you're back. She's everywhere. She's ubiquitous. You can keep your seat if you want, or you can stand wherever you want to do. Will your anchor hold in the storm? Oh, yes, Betty.
Thank you.
7. This is part of the same text that we read last week. Let me read it for you. Philippians 4, verses 4 to 7, where the Apostle Paul writes, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Amen. Well, this morning our order of service has been changed a little bit. That's empty. And the technical services person has just been warned by this wireless microphone in front of me that it's going to die in a few minutes because there's a little red light flashing. So if you'll just bear with me. We have to hire a tech support guy, you know. Someone who's on top of things. Knows what's going on. But now you'll see how this works. You see, I got a what? I unscrewed the wrong one. I feel like anti-ring with a flashlight. That's the wrong one. Where is it? Oh, it's that one. That's where it is. You see, there's some batteries in here. It's a good thing I know how to do this, or I'd really be embarrassed. There's even more than I am now. So I put these batteries in, and hopefully I'll get in the right way. There, put that on. It's a good thing I had a couple of new batteries. They were the last ones I had. Hello. We're back. Well, that was interesting, wasn't it? The sermon title, as you can see up on the screen, is "Who Do You Trust?" Obviously, you don't trust your tech support guy because he's not doing his job. Anyway, I remember way, way back in my days as part of a large corporation. I remember one weekend in particular, all of the company executives and the managers spending time away from the office and going up to the beautiful Nottawasaga Inn. Have you ever been there? It's a beautiful, beautiful spot. And at that place, you could play golf. Well, I didn't, because I had never played golf before, and I didn't want to be embarrassed. But there was also great food, and I'm good at eating, so I enjoyed that. And there was lots of sunshine and relaxation as well. But now, after all of these many years, looking back on it, I can see that the real purpose of the weekend was actually largely to brainwash us into giving even more of our non-paid private time to the mighty corporation. That's what it was all about. Now, in my case, as the one in charge of all things technical, even back then, in charge of the company's information technology platforms, it was my job to keep them running smoothly, to make sure that was happening 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The corporation depended on it across the country. And so for me, it was even more of an insult, because for a long time, I had already been at their mercy 24/7. I routinely carried around a cell phone. You remember the cell phones way back then? You carried in a bag. They were heavy, clunky. I went from a bag to a brick to a flip phone to the whatever. Anyway, they had me. I was their slave already, so. Whatever. The others had more fun than I did, as I recall, because I still had my cell phone on me. I was on call even though I was at the resort. Get it? Okay, enough of that. The other reason they told us for that weekend away was to talk to us about team building. Now, on the first Saturday we were there, we were introduced to something called Trust Falls. Ever heard of trust falls? Well, if you haven't, trust falls are exercises where one colleague falls backward and trust their peers, the others, to catch them before they go crashing to the earth. Now, if you've never done that, believe me, it is not an easy thing to do. Now, for me in particular, I even have trouble falling backwards into a pool or off a dock. It's just really, really scary for me, but I guess I must have done it. It was a long time ago, but I guess I did it. The purpose of trust falls is to teach team members that they can trust one another. And the idea is that by learning how to trust each other outside of the office environment, that therefore that back in the office, that the teams will feel more comfortable and confident working together on projects. It's a good idea. I don't know if they still do that nowadays, but back then it was a new idea. Well, so much for reminiscing about the old days of the office. Why am I telling you all this? Well, the basic problem back then, and it still troubles people today, and probably all of you too, is you wonder, who can I trust? And that's even more so today, isn't it? With all the stuff going on out there, who can I trust? And now, especially when your well-being and maybe our own lives might one day depend on it. One of the obvious reasons I expect the majority of people fear falling backwards is that they can't see what or who is back there, obviously. All they can hear is, as that song said a long time ago, the sound of silence. It's scary. Now, I want to ask you, do you feel that way when it comes to the presence of God? God? Are you really there? I can't see you. I can't hear you, right? It's hard. It's like falling backwards into what? But I was thinking as I was preparing this, I was thinking, you know, if any of us actually felt God's touch behind us, we'd probably have a heart attack then, right? I know I would, that's for sure. Okay, now with all that in mind, getting back to Paul's letter to the Philippians. Think about Paul, who is the author of this letter. He's in jail as he writes this. He's alone. No one has got his back. He doesn't know when or if he'll ever get out. He's isolated from everything familiar to him. This was his first time of, for an extended time, being behind bars. I can't even imagine what it would be like. Have you ever thought about that? What would it be like? Can't make a phone call, of course, obviously, you couldn't make a phone call. Couldn't send a text message, obviously. All he could do was write a letter, which is what he did. He wrote several while he was in prison. But there was no place to post it. There was no guaranteed 5-day delivery. But he did have one friend. His name was Epaphroditus. Now, I don't know if any parents today who would name their kid Epaphroditus, but I guess back then it didn't seem so weird. He had a friend named Epaphroditus, and he said that he would hand deliver the letter for him to this destination back in Philippi, in Macedonia. But that would likely take months for it to happen, and in the meantime, all that Paul could do was to wait. I don't know about you, but of all the four-letter words I don't like, wait is among them. It's really hard to do. We aren't given any blow-by-blow account of those days when Paul was in prison, as he's struggling with many things, and he's writing in this letter. But we can make an educated guess that it must have been, among many other things, it must have been incredibly frustrating for him. Why do I say that? Well, because in chapter 2, verses 25, 26, Paul writes this: "I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs." Now let's stop there just a minute. Paul is saying that Epaphroditus was a colleague in the ministry. He was from Philippi, and that's why Paul calls him, as he writes the letter, he calls him your messenger, because Epaphroditus was from Philippi. So the church back there had heard that Paul was in jail, in chains, but he was under house arrest. Now, house arrest doesn't sound too awfully bad for us. I would hate to be. Being under house arrest, think about during COVID. We all felt when we were under house arrest, right? But it was much, much different back then. Everybody knew back then that the prisoner had to pay rent for his prison. And he had to provide for his own food and clothing. And prisoners today that think that they've got it rough. So the Philippians had taken up an offering and sent Epaphroditus with the money to Paul. And now Paul is sending back a letter, a thank you letter, to the church in Philippi. We get it, right? It makes perfect sense. Now, whenever I was talking about how frustrating it must have been for Paul, again, an innocent man. He'd done nothing wrong. He'd been accused, but nothing wrong. Now he was a convicted felon. Completely innocent. Not only that, he had been beaten and thrown in jail, far from home, far from everything familiar to him. It was horrible. But Epaphroditus had come, sent by the Philippian church to take care of him. Great. Paul knew the folks back in Philippi. He was there when that church started. He helped to found that church. So he knew all the folks back there. Now, as Paul is writing to thank them, we find in verse 26, it's easy to miss it, Paul says, "Epaphroditus longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard he was ill." Now, what does that mean? Paul's mailman couldn't do the job. Paul wrote the letter, Epaphroditus couldn't deliver it because he was sick. And we don't know how long he was sick, who knows, but we can imagine how frustrating it must have been for Paul. But finally, Epaphroditus was finally well enough to travel. The letter was on its way, and history tells us that indeed it was delivered. Okay, now, on the other side, imagine for a minute that our community church, pretend that we're located in Philippi, Macedonia. Try to imagine that. Your minister, who's Pastor Paul, has just sent you this letter from prison in Rome. You've got the letter now. So first let me ask you, just in passing, if I had a prison record, me, would you have hired me? Not very likely. But I'm asking anyway, because I hope that one day, I sincerely hope that one day I will have a successor. And I really want that to happen because that will mean that this church is still alive.
Amen.
After I'm gone. I want not to be the last man standing here on this pulpit. So when you're looking for a new pastor, when that day comes, I advise you to make sure that you hire the person that God wants. Not the one with the nicest looking resume. You never know what you're going to get. But if you get the person God wants, you've got the right person. Okay. You got the letter. It's a Sunday morning, and say that the clerk of session starts reading to you From chapter 2, verse 24, Paul says this. Are you ready? And I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. And do you get that? You say, wow! What a man of faith! Imagine! Get out of prison? Really? Nobody gets out of prison. Free? Coming here to lead us again? How could Paul say, well, what a guy? I'll be there soon, he says. My old grandma Abby, whom I still miss, I sort of grew up with her in the house with us. I never forget my grandma Abby. Whenever we had a supper, she had a rule. It was our house, so she was living with us, but she had a rule that ketchup wasn't allowed on the table. We weren't going to spoil her cooking with ketchup. So when Veronica's down teaching Sunday school, when Veronica and I got married, by the way, I said to her, of course she's joking, I said, Veronica, I want you to know that the only ground for divorce will be in our marriage will be if ever you run out of ketchup. I love this stuff. Anyway, my dear Grandma Abby would have said, when she heard, if she were there in the congregation, that Paul was going to be free, she would have said, that warms the cockles of me heart. Yeah. I have no idea what that means. But that's what she, and you're nodding, so you heard the same thing too. Lovely, lovely. But would you believe him? He said, I'm going to be there soon. I'm getting out of here. Would you be listening? Would you? Oh, could the seemingly impossible really happen? Now, I am no Apostle Paul, obviously, far, far from it. But would you believe me when I tell you that the Lord God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth and all of the universe beyond, the one who loved this world so much that he sent his very self in the person of his son to save the souls of men and women and boys and girls. And the one who, when he comes again, will save this world from destruction by the enemy of our souls. That's what's going to happen. The first time Jesus came was to save souls, to open the door to heaven. The second time he comes will be to save the earth. That's a whole series of sermons, maybe sometime next year. That same Lord God Almighty, the same one who lit that fire in the hearts of those dear pioneers 191 years ago to build this church, it is that one, God alone, who will extinguish the light. And he'll do it when he decides. Listen, that will only happen. This is very solemn. I believe this. This will only happen if we choose to make it happen. Those who are here this morning, those who are watching, if we choose to make that happen. God never, never, ever forces anyone to love him. Never. He never forces anyone to receive Jesus, his son, as their Savior and Lord. And God will never, never force us to love him enough to do our part to keep this church alive. But if we will, God will. I believe that. If we love him enough to believe what seems to be the impossible, God will keep us alive. And if you can't believe me, if you can't trust me, trust God. Trust the Word of God. Trust Him. Now, in closing, let's take a look at that short, familiar sermon text that you heard. Let me read it again. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, can you imagine the effect that this had on those folks back then? When Epaphroditus read them that letter from Paul when he finally arrived, did they trust their pastor Paul? Yes, they did. It didn't matter to them that in the eyes of the law, he was a convicted felon. They didn't care. They still sent him money and a man, one of their own, to help him. Paul had their total support. And by the way, that's very nice for any pastor to know. They must have been astounded to hear that he believed he was going to be freed. And if some of them had a hard time believing that that could ever happen, they must have been pretty embarrassed when sometime later Paul showed up at that church in Philippi. He was there. They had a true man of faith as their pastor, and now this pastor, this man of faith, this one who dared to believe what they probably thought was impossible, now in the midst of all this distress and suffering and hopeless surroundings, he's still in jail, as he writes. He says to them, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. The Lord is near. Could we this morning find the faith to say the same thing? Rejoice, the Lord is near. I'll say it. Lord, we rejoice that you have brought us this far by faith. And we rejoice that you will never forsake us. We believe, as Paul wrote, that you are near. We believe it. Then Paul wrote, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Can we trust Paul? Can we trust this man of faith behind prison bars? Let me say it for us. Yes. We trust what Paul said. And more than that, we trust his Lord and ours. But it's hard for us. I know, I'm right here in the same boat with you. So, God understands when we say, Lord, we will determine, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to trust you. We will simply bring all of our burdens, all of our cares, all of our needs, all of our fears, all of our hopes and visions, all of our dreams to you. And so we will trust you and you alone for our future. And Lord, we thank you that because you give us the faith to do this, right now, right here, we receive the peace of God that transcends all of our understanding. That means we can have peace before we understand what's happening. We think we need to understand before we can have peace. No. Just the opposite. Get it? We don't need to understand in order to have peace because we know who we can trust. Simple as that. Lord, now we thank you that we can trust you as you have promised to guard our hearts and our minds. That means to post a sentinel, to post a watch guard, to guard our hearts and our minds. That means our emotions and our intellect, get it? To guard our hearts and our minds. Why? Because, thank God, we are in Christ Jesus. Amen. God bless you as you give to the work of the Lord. Because we have confidence in you, we give this morning from our hearts. We give to make sure that your work can continue in this place and that we may help to spread the light, to let the light shine forth as long as we have breath. We thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the nice things about the old hymns is that all these years later, 100 or so years later, we look back on the words and we say, hey, it was just like it was, what's the same? Simply trusting every day. That's how they got along, and that's how we get along too. Let's sing it together. Simply trusting every day. 689 in the Blue Book. Here we go.
Thank you.
Jesus, we trust your promises. We thank you, Holy Spirit of God. We trust that you really are here with us, present in this church and in our hearts. And we pray as we leave this place today that we will take your presence with us. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.